Narayana Namaskritya Narachava Narottamam Devam Sarasatin Vyasan Tato Jaya Mudiraje Nasta Prajiswa Badresu Nitya Bhagavata Sivaya Bhagavati Uttamas Loke Bhakti Bhavati Nastiki Vede Ramane Chaiva Purane Bharati Tata Hadancha Mangita Hari Savata Giyate Mukam Kurti Vashalan Frangu Langate Grihim Yakipata Ham Vande Sri Guru Dinatarine Paramananda Madhava Dhamma Prajita Kaita Bhuta Paramonim Sharam Satan Vedyan Vastavam Atavasu Svarna Tapatayo Mulana Sima Bhagavati Mahamani Kinteki Vaipara Isvara Sadyoridi Abharuti Trakitvita Krishnan Yashavasriyamanayam Krishna Paramapuruse Bhakti Uttapade Bhunzan Sukha Moha Bhayapaha Atoyam Brahma Sutanam Bharatata Bininaya Gayatri Vasya Rupo Subhidata Paribhimita Sabhavidhiti Yashanam Saram Saram Paribhimita Sabhavidhantan Sarahim Sri Bhakta Misyate Tarasamitasya Tiptasya Nayatasya Rati Kvachi Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya So it's stated in the scriptures that Tat Rasamitasya Tiptasya Nanyatasya Rati Kuchit that if one has tasted the Srimad Bhagavatam, if one has tasted the nectarian essence of Bhagavatam, that nothing else will be tasteful in this material world, just by tasting Srimad Bhagavatam. Because Bhagavatam is Krishna himself, Krishna Sadhama Pagati, Dhamma Gyana, Kalo Nasana Dushana Esa Purana Kudinodita, that Krishna, he left the planet 5,000 years ago, he took away everything with him, his devotees, his dharma, everything. Now, what was left, again, Krishna again incarnated himself, he manifested himself in the form of Srimad Bhagavatam, that in this age of Kali, people shall get light by recitation of Srimad Bhagavatam. So Srila Bhaktisiddhanta, he used to say that if every book in this world is burnt to ashes and only Bhagavatam is left, he said nothing is lost. You know, if every book in library, like you have so many libraries, Library of Congress, if all of them are burnt to ashes and only Bhagavatam is left, nothing is lost. So therefore, the injunction was that every household should have Bhagavatam in their house. And a house that does not have Bhagavatam, that house is no better than a crematorium. So just a minute. So which means as a devotee, we should not go to that house that does not contain Srimad Bhagavatam. Or we should make as much effort as possible to make sure every household have set up Bhagavatam in their house. Then that house will be as good as Vaikuntha. Okay. Grantra Srimad Bhagavatam ki. So today, we are reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 6, Chapter 9, Text number 10, The Appearance of the Demon Vritrasura. Dravya Bhuyo Varinapas Turiyam Jagruho Malang Tasu Buddha. Buddha. Phenabhyam. Dristam. Ta. Dharati. Kshpan. Dravabhuyo varena pas. Turayam jagruhu malam. Tasu buddha phenabhyam. Dristanta dharatikshipan. Dravya bhuyo varena pas. Turayam jagruhu malam. Tasu buddha phenabhyam. Distam ta dharatikshipam. Dravya bhuyo varena pas. Turayam jagruhu malam. Tasu buddha phenabhyam. Distam ta dharatikshipam. You can chant. Chant? Okay. Dravya, other things, Bhuya, of increasing, Varena, by the benediction, Apaha, water, Turiyan, one-fourth, Jagruhu, accepted, Malam, the sinful reaction, Tasu, in the water, Buddha Phenabhyam, by bubbles and foam, Dristam, visible, Tat, that Harati, one collects, Kshipan, throwing away. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivinoda Swami Srila Prabhupada, Srila Prabhupada ki. And in return for King Indra's benediction, that water will increase the volume of other substances with which it was mixed, water accepted one-fourth of the sinful reactions. Therefore, There are bubbles and foam in water. When one collects water, this should be avoided. Translation responsively. And in return for King Indra's benediction, that water will increase the volume of other substances with which it was mixed. Water accepted one-fourth of the sinful reactions. Therefore, there are bubbles and foam in water. When one collects water, this should be avoided. Purport. If water is mixed with milk, fruit juice, or other similar substances, it increases their volume, and no one can understand which has increased. In return for this benediction, water accepted one-fourth of Indra's sinful reactions. These sinful reactions are visible in foam and bubbles. Therefore, one should avoid foam and bubbles while collecting drinking water. Gurave Gura Chandra Yarajikata Dala Ye Krishna Ya Krishna Bhaktaya Tabataya Namo Namaha Agena Timindasya Agena Gana Salakaya Chakshumita Yena Tasmashi Gurave Namo Vanchaka Bhattavya Cha Kripa Sing Viva Cha Pati Itana Pavana Vibhya Vashna Vibhya Namo Namaha Dravya Bhuyo Bari Napas Turiyan Jagrahu Malam Tasu Budbuddha Finabhyam Dishtanta Dharatik Shpan. And in return for King Indra's benediction that water will increase the volume of other substances with which it was mixed, water accepted one-fourth of the sinful reactions. Therefore, there are bubbles and foam in the water. When one collects water, this should be avoided. So, from the beginning of this chapter, we learn how Vishwarup was appointed as the priest of the demigods. Namale, Brihaspati is the guru or the priest of the demigods. Just as yesterday, Srivas Prabhu was explaining how Brihaspati became angry with Indra because of his offense. So the guru was away. But at the same time, the universal management have to go on. So in order for this to go on, so Lord Brahma requested the demigod that they should approach Vishwarup, who was very competent priest to do what is necessary for the demigods. But it so happened that Vishwarup, he has a mixed parentage. One side of his parents are Brahmanas or the demigods, and another side of his parents are demoniac. Actually, both the demigods and the demons, they all have the same origin. They were both the offspring of Kashyapa, Diti and Aditi. They were both the wife of Kashyapa Muni. So from Diti, all the demons came from Ditis. And from Aditi, all the demigods came. So basically, both the demons and demigods, they were Brahmanas, because Kashyapa is a Brahmana. So that makes the demigods and demons Brahmanas. So traditionally, there's always been competition between the two over who's going to predominate. Competition has always been good. However, the demigods, they usually work for the benefit of the humanity, of the universe, And the demigods, they were appointed by the Supreme Lord himself for the universal affairs, for the universal management. Whereas the demons, they are always creating disruptions. Because the demons, because of their selfish nature, you know, their goal is simply sense gratification. So because their goal is sense gratification, so they will do whatever it takes just to fulfill that. So therefore, always from time to time, the demigods, the demons, they always finding looking for different ways by which they can take over the domain of the demigods. So in this particular situation, because the demigods, they've lost their kingdom because of the offenses to their guru, so they lost everything. So that's why spiritual life is very, very delicate. Like Sanatana Goswami, he was explaining in the beginning of Hari Bhakti Vilas that spiritual life is like a razor's edge. It's like a razor's edge. Just like women, every morning normally you shave your face every morning. You shave every day. And if you're not careful, you can always get caught. If you don't pay proper attention while you are shaving, you can get caught. You can wound yourself. So spiritual life is like that, which means it must be delicate. Because it's based on the satisfaction of guru. So which means if guru is not pleased, one cannot attain any goal. Yasa prasada, bhagava prasada, yasa prasada na gati kutubi, which means if the guru is pleased, one can attain Bhagavan. One can attain the goal of life, and if the guru is not pleased, then one can lose everything. So that was the position. So that was the reason why the demigods, they have to lose everything, you know. So Vishwarup, he was called to do the sacrifice for the demigods. But the same time, Vishwarup, even though he wanted to act on behalf of the demigods, but at the same time, he has some partiality towards the demons. Because after all, he is related to both. He has both relation. He is related to the demigods, and he's also related to the demons. So the time for sacrifice come, and this sacrifice was meant to give victory to the demigods. You know, in the beginning, when Vishwarup, when he was chanting the mantra, he was chanting the mantra so that the demigods Indra could be benefited. You know, like Idam Indraya, Idam Swaha, Idam Agnaya Swaha. So he was chanting many of these mantra so that the demigods headed by Indra, Agni, they could become victorious, they could be benefited. But at the same time, because of his partiality towards the demons, he was also chanting some mantra to benefit the demons. Though he was chanting it very secretly, not so loud, he was doing it very silently, chanting the mantra, you know. So the other demigods, they did not hear it. They thought, oh, Vishwarup is doing a wonderful thing by chanting this mantra on our behalf. However, Indradev is much more intelligent, much more shrewd. So he could understand that, oh, this fellow is also chanting the mantra to benefit the demons. This is a cheating. Because his commission was to perform this sacrifice to benefit the demigods. So why is he doing this? So this is cheating. So Indra, he became angry. So immediately he took off his weapon and removed the head of Vishwarup, cut off his head. So, you know, one thing, Indra could be said not to be at fault. After all, he has to do what is necessary. That this fellow was cheating, you know, by not doing what he was supposed to be doing, by doing something, you know, to benefit the opponent of the demigods. So therefore, he deserved to be killed. You know, just like when you read the Mahabharata, you find many, many of these circumstances. Sometimes you find somebody cheating, and then the person will be killed immediately. However, because Vishwarupa was a brahmana, so being a brahmana is not supposed to be killed. And the sin of killing a brahmana is most grievous sin. Is the most grievous to kill a brahmana, brahmahatya. It's so difficult to nullify the sinful activity of killing a brahmana. So Indradev, so he find himself in a situation whereby, yes, he killed a brahmana, but at the same time he realized that what he did was actually not good by killing a brahmana. So immediately after killing Vishwarupa, so he became full of remorse that, oh, what have I done? How come I've done this, killing a brahmana? Because we know the brahmana class, this is the most exalted class. The brahmanas, they are very, very dear to Lord Vishnu. We say namo brahmanya devayago brahmanacharya. The brahmanas and the goat and the cows, these two items, they are the most dear to Krishna. They are the most dear to the Lord. So how could you kill a brahmana? Even the Lord himself will not do anything that is antagonistic to the brahmanas. He will not do that, even the Lord himself. We find the case of Bhrigu Muni. So Bhrigu Muni, you know, it is a brahmana. He, along with other sages, they were debating among themselves as to who is the supreme. They were debating among themselves who is the supreme. They could not figure out who is the supreme. Is it Lord Shiva? Is it Lord Brahma? Or is it Lord Vishnu? So because they could not come to the conclusion as to who is the supreme, so Bhrigu, he was deputed, he was asked to go and find out who among these three deities are the supreme. Who among them is the supreme? So he was given that commission. So Bhrigu Muni went. First he went to his father. His father is Lord Brahma. So when he went to his father to test his father, so when his father saw him coming, so his father was very, very happy. He said, oh, my son is coming. He was very coming. So he wanted to go and embrace, he wanted to embrace him. But Bhrigu said, no, you can't, you know. Then he was actually thinking in his mind. He did not say anything. He just thought within his mind that, no, I cannot let my father embrace me. You know, he cannot be the supreme. He was kind of thinking offensively within his mind. He kind of just stayed. So when he's approaching his father, he did not pay any respect. Which Lord Brahma, he is the creator of the universe. Every stage is, they are chanting prayers, everything, just for glorification of Lord Brahma. But here's Bhrigu coming. He did not pay any regard. He did not show any regard to his father. So immediately Lord Brahma became angry. He thought of killing him, but at the same time also he was able to restrain himself. So he did not kill Bhrigu. So Bhrigu said, well, if Lord Brahma could get angry, he could not be the supreme. And then he left. Then Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva is his brother, because both Brahma and Bhrigu, they are both came from Lord Brahma. So they were considered to be brothers. So at that time, when Bhrigu went, at that time, Lord Shiva, he was engaging in meditation. You know, he was engaging in tapasya. But with his third eye, because Lord Shiva has three eyes. So even though he was engaging in meditation, so with his third eye, he saw that, oh, Bhrigu was coming. So he immediately opened his eyes, and then he wanted to embrace Bhrigu. Bhrigu, he said, oh no, don't touch me. Look at you. You're always associating with all kind of low-class people, your friends, your associate are the ghost, demons. So therefore, you are very dirty person. You always, you know, you live in a cemetery, all these things. So I cannot be touched by you because you are very dirty. I can't be touched by you. You know, he says such a thing to Lord Shiva. So you can just imagine. So Lord Shiva said, how dare you? How dare you say that? So Lord Shiva took his trident. He wanted to immediately cut off his head. But luckily, so Parvati was there, his wife was there. He said, oh, this is your brother. Why are you getting angry with your brother? Don't kill him. He's your brother. So in this way, and then of course the Bhrigu went to pay his respect to Shiva. He said, I just came here to test you only, so therefore accept my apology, you know, like that. So in this way, Bhrigu knew that yes, Shivaji could not be the supreme. And then he went to the Lord Vishnu's planet. And at that time, you know, Lord Vishnu, he's always been massaged by Lakshmi Devi at his feet. So Lord Vishnu, he was lying down on his bed of Seshanak, he was lying down, and he was being massaged by Lakshmi. So when Bhrigu arrived, he saw that Vishnu was reclining nicely, being massaged by Lakshmi Devi. He was relaxing nicely. So Bhrigu, what did he do? He simply jumped up and kicked the chest of Vishnu. He said, oh, Vishnu, don't you see me coming? And then he kicked the leg of Vishnu, the chest of Vishnu. You can just imagine such a great offense, kicking the chest of the Lord. Amen. The chest of the Lord, that's the resident of Lakshmiji. And this Brahmana come and kicking the Lord's chest. This is unimaginable offense, unimaginable. However, Lord Vishnu did not take offense. He did not take offense at all. He says, oh, my dear Brahmana, I'm so sorry that I did not see you coming. And you have kicked my chest, and my chest is very, very hard. You must have hurt yourself. And then he took the leg of Bhrigu, and I was massaging it. He said, oh, you must have hurt yourself while kicking my chest. He was massaging the leg of Bhrigu. So Bhrigu realized, oh, look at the Lord. Look, I've done this such a horrible act, and the Lord was not even angry at me. And he was, you know, just massaging my foot. So of course, he became convinced that, yes, this is the Supreme Lord himself. He's the Supreme Lord. And then Bhrigu was full of ecstasy, and he was in offering prayers, in offering worship to the Lord. Because the Brahmanas are very, very exalted. Under any circumstance, should anyone be angry at the Brahmanas? Under any circumstance. But in this particular situation, Indra cut off the Vishwarup in this circumstance. So, now, as commented earlier by Srila Vishnu Chakravartipad in the beginning of this chapter, that Indradev, not only is he a demigod, he's also a devotee. He's also a devotee of the Lord. He's in that position of Indradev because he was appointed by the Lord to be for that post of Indra. Because Indra is a post. Indra is a position by which any exalted person can attain that position. So which means you don't become Indra just like that. You know. So an Indra being a devotee, I mean, just like Vamandev is his brother, because they are both sons of Kashyapa Muni. Even the Lord in his famous Upendra, he lives perpetually in the palace of Indra. He's always there in the palace of Indra. So they're actually brothers, you know. So Indra himself is a devotee himself. Indra is also a Brahmana, and is as powerful as any Brahmana. So Indra could easily nullify the offense of killing the Vishwarup. He could easily nullify it. However, because devotees, they are such that when they see themselves doing something wrong, they feel, how grievous is this sin which I've committed? And they actually show repentance. Because that's the quality of devotees. You know, devotees are not the one who want to show any form of retaliation. You know, that, don't you know that I'm also very powerful and all that? No, devotees don't do that. We find the case of Parikshit Maharaj. When Parikshit Maharaj, when he was in the, he was going in the forest, and he became very, very thirsty. He became very, very thirsty, and he was looking for a way by which he could quench his thirst. So he saw the ashram, what's his name? The Rishi? Samika Rishi, he found his ashram. So he went inside, and he saw that the sage was engaged in meditation. The sage actually did not know that the king was entering. But in Parikshit, he took this as offense, because according to the Vedic etiquette, that if someone is visiting you, you have to show some kind of, welcome. It's an Atithi Devo Bhava, that a guest is like God. If a guest is visiting you, you must immediately give everything, whatever you have. If you cannot give the food, at least give the water, something like that. But so Parikshit Maharaj felt himself neglected, so he became angry, and then he put out a dead snake. I put it as a garland on the neck of the sage. And then he went away. Of course, in the meanwhile, Sringi, Samika Rishi's son, so he came and saw what has happened to his father. So he became angry, and of course, he caused Parikshit Maharaj to die within 7 days by a snake bite. But as Parikshit Maharaj was going, so he realized what he has done. That, I've committed such a great offense to a Brahmana. What have I done? This is totally unbecoming for a person like myself. You know, he said, Parikshit Maharaj is a devotee. Not just a devotee, he's one of the top, the highest caliber of devotee. He's called Vishnurat, who is always under the protection of Lord Vishnu. So Parikshit Maharaj, he felt a great remorse that, this activity I've done is such a grievous act. So therefore, whatever punishment that will come to me, let it come to me. So he reposed himself to welcome any form of punishment that may come to him. Even though being a great devotee, he could have nullified whatever cause that the Brahmana's son would have given to him. He could have done that, but he chose not to do that. He simply welcomed the reaction to the particular offense. So in this way, the devotees, this is their mood. This is their mood. So, similarly also, so Indra, he decided to undergo the punishment that may come. He decided to go the reaction. So for 1 year, he was performing so many reformatory acts prayascha. Prayascha means the atonement. So for 1 year, he was performing the atonement. And after 1 year, still, that offense of killing a Brahmana was still not nullified. So therefore, he made the arrangement with four different elements, with the trees, with the earth, with the woman, and then with the water, as we have read before. You know, with the earth, by giving a benediction to the earth, so that the earth, whenever there is a spot on the ground, the water can be filled up. So, by taking the one quarter of the sinful reaction of Indra, so some portion of the earth can remain deserted, can be like a desert. So which means wherever there's a desert, this is a result of sinful reaction, and the desert is not a place to fit for any form of religious worship, which means there cannot be any kind of fire sacrifice wherever there's a desert. And then for the tree, and in the return for the benediction, whereby if any branches of leaves of the trees are cut, those branches or the leaf, they will grow back. So in return for that benediction, so the tree, they can produce sap. And that sap is not fit for consumption. If you consume that, you're basically consuming a sinful reaction. And then for yesterday, we heard about the woman who agreed to take the sinful reaction of Indra in exchange for them to be unlimitedly lusty. And for that exchange of sinful, for that exchange, they agreed that once a month they will have a menstrual period, so that at that time men cannot approach them at that particular time. And then today we're hearing that the volume of water will increase if it mixes with any other substance, like it can be juice or whatever. The volume will increase, and for that exchange, there is bubbles. The water, there's foam and bubble, and which is not fit to be drunk, which means one cannot drink bubbles of water or the foam. If you won't do that, it's considered to be sinful. So these are the various areas by which one can perform some kind of atonement for one's sinful reaction. So this is what Indra had done. So as I mentioned in the beginning, because the Brahmanas, they are such a high class of individuals, the topmost class, they are the head of all Varnas, everything like that, and their position is so exalted. Throughout the whole Vedic scriptures, the glories of the Brahmanas are proclaimed throughout the whole Vedic scriptures. In the Mahabharata, it was mentioning that Indrupi Esan Pranamate Kim Puna Manavobubi Brahmana Hyagni Sadrisha Daheyo Prativimapi Ape Ya Sagara Krodat Kitohi Labano Dakaha Yesan Krodagni Adyapi Dandake Nopasam Yet Bahu Prabhavat Suyante Brahmananam Mahatmanam. So the glories of the Brahmana, it's mentioned that even Indra, the king of the demigods, offers obeisances to the Brahmanas. So what can be said of the people of earth? The Brahmanas are as powerful as fire. If they want, they can burn the entire world to ashes. The water of the ocean is salty and therefore undrinkable due to the anger of the Brahmanas. The fire in the Dandakaranya forest started by the Brahmanas' anger cannot be extinguished even today. Many similar glories of the pious Brahmanas are heard. And then from Vishnu Damodara was also mentioned, Deva Paroksha Deva Pratyaksha Deva Brahmanaha Brahmanai Loka Dhayate Brahmananam prasadena divi tishtanti devataha Brahmana vihitam vakya na mitya jayate kuchit Ya Brahmanas tu starnam vadanti ta devata patya binandana yanti tustesu tusta satatam bhavanti pratyaksha devesu paroksha devaha. They say, the demigods are not seen by gross senses. The Brahmanas are manifestations of the demigods. The Brahmanas sustain all the planets. The demigods reside in the heavenly planets by the mercy of the Brahmanas. The Brahmanas' words can never be false. Whatever the Brahmanas speak in great satisfaction is accepted by the demigods. When the manifested forms of the demigods, the Brahmanas are satisfied, the demigods, who are beyond sense perception are also satisfied. I know there is another one. This is from the Dharma Sastras. It mentioned that Sastram Ekakinam Hanti Vipramanyu Kulakshayam Chak Chakrativra Taromanyus Tasma Viprana Kopayet Raja Dahati Dandena Vipu Dahati Manjuna. A weapon can destroy only one person, but the anger of a Brahmana can destroy one's entire family. The anger of a Brahmana is more fiercely powerful than a disc. So, one should not make a Brahmana angry. A king burns through his punishment, while a Brahmana burns through his anger. So, which means the offense of the Brahmanas is the most grievous offense. Which means one has to be very, very careful. Even if one is offended by a Brahmana, one should never take any form of reaction. Even one is offended. We found the story of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in Jagannath Puri. So when the Lord was, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was in Puri, so that time Ramachandra Puri was a god brother of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's spiritual master, Ishwara Puri. But Ramachandra Puri, he had a habit of criticizing everyone. He's a fault finder. So which means, if you go to a house of a devotee, he will observe what they are doing. Or sometimes, he will invite the devotees to feed them. He will feed them so nicely, give them more than necessary, and once devotees have finished eating, he will say, oh, I've heard that you devotees of Chaitanya, you eat too much. So, and I can see this by myself. So in this way, all he does is nothing but fault finding. So, then one day, he went to the house of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, to Mahaprabhu. He went there after Mahaprabhu's have just finished eating. And then so when he went there, then he saw some ants crawling on the ground. And he said, oh, now I've seen that now, so you eat too much. Too many sweets. This is not fit for a sannyasi. You know, I've heard so many people saying about the same thing now. I can now see with my own eye what you are doing as a sannyasi, eating too much sweet. So what kind of sannyasi is this? So after criticizing Mahaprabhu, so he left. So Mahaprabhu, he did not take any offense. What he did, he simply told Govinda, he said, Govinda, from today on, I simply want to eat just one quarter of a portion of what I normally eat. And if you give me more than this from today on, I'm going to leave this place. So Mahaprabhu gave that order to Govinda. And when Govinda, he related this order to all the devotees, so all the devotees, they feel, oh, what is this? This is a great calamity that we can no longer feed Mahaprabhu. And the Lord was so adamant about it. He said, no, because Ramachandra Puri, he has said the right thing. It's not the duty of a sannyasi to be eating so much. So therefore, I'm only going to be eating as little as possible. Even though so many, many devotees went to Mahaprabhu, even the god brother of Ramachandra Puri, in the Paramananda Puri, they went to Mahaprabhu, tell him that, look, this Ramachandra Puri is my god brother. I know him very well, very, very well. This is his habit to criticize he's always looking for the fault of the devotees rather than looking for their good quality. You only look for the fault. So therefore, don't take him serious. You should resume your eating. So Mahaprabhu said, no, I'm not going to do this. He said, Mahaprabhu, he keeps on the same thing that Ramachandra Puri has said the right thing. That is not the duty of a sannyasi to be eating as much as possible. So Mahaprabhu maintained this in strict vow. So after some time, so Ramachandra Puri, he left Jagannath Puri, he left. And then of course the devotees, they felt a great relief that this person had gone away. So and then they went to Mahaprabhu and related to him that this person has gone, so you can resume your eating. So then Mahaprabhu, he told the devotee, he said that Why all of you are angry at Ramachandra Puri? Why are you all angry at him? He has said the right thing of what should be the dharma of his sannyasis. Why all of you are angry at him? So Mahaprabhu did not even take a slight offense. He did not even consider it. Whatever Ramachandra Puri has done, being a fault finder, you know. Because why? Because Ramachandra Puri was a brahmana. He did not consider his offense. What he just said, whatever I said, you know, that is the truth, whatever I said. So in this way, there are a lot of lessons that you can learn about being offensive to the brahmana. And of course, we know that the brahmanas, they are, a Vaishnava is much more higher than a brahmana. So he mentioned here that those personalities who are actually the great brahmanas, the greatest brahmanas, that bhakti kshata prapanas cha brahmanas te prakritita, that therefore those who have taken shelter of the Lord, of the absolute truth, through by devotion and attachment are known as the true brahmanas. So which means the careful has to be done in the consideration of dealing with devotees. Because the devotees, they are the greatest brahmana. So that's why one has to be, one should rather praise a person than stand to be offensive to them. One should never consider that, oh, this person has done this, man, this wrong, so therefore, let me retaliate. That is never any consideration. So this story of Indra dealing with the killing of Vishwarup, by which, again, because of this killing, then Vishwarup's father became very angry, by which he has to perform some other sacrifice, whereby Indra himself could be killed. So this story goes on in the following verses. So I'm going to stop here. So thank you very much for patiently listening. Any question or comment? Some commentary? So many senior versions are here. Some comment? Panchakota Prabhu, want to do some comments? Because those four items, they are considered to be sinful. The benefit, is it? Oh, okay. So you're asking that what is the benefit of avoiding those four items? Well, because basically at the end of every chapter of the Bhagavatam, there's always it's called a Shruti Phalam, the fruit of hearing. So because this is Puranic stories, stories of the Purana, it was also mentioned that if one hear these narrations, at the end of every chapter you find this, if one hear this narration, then one will certainly, you know, the relief of let me see, at the end of this chapter, what is the fruit it says here? The Shruti Phal. Well, the benefit is not listed here at the end. They did not put the benefit here. But the, and I don't want to speculate about what benefits should be. But basically, because those four things, which should be avoided in terms of performing sacrifice in the desert, or drinking a tree's zap, or women having sex during the menstrual cycle, or drinking the, or taking the form of bubbles, So basically, so those there, so the benefit of hearing, because this is Bhagavatam, obviously if you hear them, of course become purified, because Bhagavatam is not different from Krishna, you know. By hearing this, we become devoted. That is the end result. Hearing this, we become more devoted. That's basically the basic benefit of it. And you want to add more to it? Yeah, we have to continue the hearing. So hearing is the medicine for getting out of this immaterial world. That's the medicine, by hearing, you know. Any other points, question? Anyway, thank you very much. After 9 o'clock. Grant Rashim Bhagavatam ki. Srila Prabhupada ki. Gopi Manande. Yeah.